What's up YouTube? It's Smart Van here, back with a new video. So today I'm going to talk about how I keep my camper van warm with a temperature sensor and remote start when it gets cold outside. This video is going to have three parts. First, I'm going to talk about why I think this is a good idea and what some of the common alternatives are. Second, I'm going to go through the build step by step. And finally, I'm going to show you some of the results that I've been seeing. Okay, are you ready? Let's get started. All right. Let's talk about the very first alternative, which is insulation. The general principle of insulation is that you want to retain all of the heat that you generate. There's a lot of forms of insulation in this van right now. For one, I'm wearing a lot, right? Like the clothing I wear right now, this hat, this sleeping bag, that's all insulation. In addition, you can see that I have the Wayfarer kit over here behind me. This is a thin layer of foam insulation that covers the bare metal that comes standard on the Cascade campers. So the deal with van insulation, right, some of this stuff that you're seeing around in the vehicle, is that it's not perfect. There's always going to be some loss, and it does take up space. And you can definitely go really crazy on the insulation side, especially if you have a larger van. But at the end of the day, insulation is not itself generating heat. It's just allowing you to keep the heat that you already have. If you're going to go this route, one of the easiest ways to be able to sleep in very, very cold climates is to get one of these sleeping bags. Because you don't have to plaster this material all over the van, it ends up being a lot smaller than it otherwise might be. And you can go to REI and buy a sleeping bag that will let you sleep in below freezing temperatures. The problem is, it's not very comfortable. Like, if you read the instructions, it says you can sleep in, you know, 15 degree weather, but it says you have to be wearing like long pajamas, you gotta wear a hat because, you know, your head gets cold at night. Then I have this other issue where my face gets cold. Then I guess I have to cover that too, but then I can't breathe. It's not the most comfortable. I mean, hey, if you like camping, you know, it gives the outside camping experience in your van, but I'm aiming for something a little bit better than this. That said, insulation is still very important because whatever heat that we generate, you know, whether from our body or through any sort of external power source, we want to be able to keep as much of that as possible. So the more insulation we have in our van, the more energy efficient we're ultimately going to be. So this next one's not really an alternative, but I have to mention it anyways, because everyone who lives in a house and is used to having power in their walls always brings this up as a potential solution. So, electric heating. Those of you who have lived on a tiny car battery in your van already know that this isn't really a valid solution, unless you have like a really big battery in your van. But for most of us, like I have a 75 amp hour battery, right? And of that, maybe like 30 amp hours are usable because you can't discharge too deep into an AGM battery, otherwise it lessens the life. So I got 30 amp hours, and let's say I want like a 150 watt heater, which is not super large. But 150 watt heater, we do some math, 150 watts divided by the 12 volts, it gives us something like 12.5 amps of current, which is a lot of current. I mean, at this level of drain, a lot of AGM batteries might actually last even less long. But assuming that, you know, it's just totally linear, even then we can power this thing for a couple hours, that's it. And then my battery is completely toast and I can't charge my iPhone at night. All right, so electricity's out, but what about propane? That's more energy dense, right? What if I just buy a Mr. Buddy heater, you know, just light that up, get it nice and warm in here? That sounds like a good idea. Except I'd have to vent my windows because these things produce a lot of moisture and carbon monoxide. Always have a carbon monoxide detector, by the way. But still, it is more dangerous than I would like to have combustion going on in such a small space. And you do end up going through these propane cylinders fairly quickly. Propane is not a particularly dense hydrocarbon. So the extra space and the increased risk of dying in my sleep means I am not going to be using a Mr. Buddy heater to keep warm. What about gasoline though? There's a company called Webasto that sells a gasoline burning furnace, and I thought it was pretty interesting, but it is a little pricey and it will also take up space if mounted on the inside. Alternatively, you can mount it on the outside. But either way, it still requires some yearly maintenance to clean up some gunk that builds up in the thing over time. It's expensive. It's not particularly quiet. But on the plus side, it's very efficient. The website says that you can run this thing for 22 hours off of a single gallon of gas. Well, there already is a gasoline-burning engine in my van, and it does produce heat, so maybe I could just reuse that. Now, you know, it's probably louder than the Webasto heater, and it does do wear and tear on the engine. It's not nearly as efficient. I looked at some figures online, and it looks like idling should burn something like 0.5 gallons per hour, which means I'm getting about 2 hours per gallon, versus the Webasto's 22 hours per gallon. But, you know, for infrequent usage, it's not such a bad idea. You know, I also don't live in a super cold climate, so I wouldn't use it that often. Most importantly, I don't have to buy something super expensive, maintain it, and find space for it. There is another issue with the engine trick, which is that it's very easy to overshoot. If I turn my engine on at the start of the night, it's probably gonna get too hot in around 15 minutes. And so I would ideally need some way to turn the engine off when it gets too hot, and then turn it back on when it gets cold enough. And that's where the temperature sensor comes into play. All right, one option is this NTC thermistor. It has a resistance that depends on the current temperature, so we could measure that resistance and use that to figure out how hot it is outside. But it's kind of a pain in the butt to use because this relationship is non-linear, so we're gonna toss that and go with the easy, lazy option. Here is the SparkFun breakout to the TMP-117 by Texas Instruments. Together, this breakout board costs less than $15 and it comes fully assembled. And this chip by Texas Instruments is just shockingly advanced. It's a full-blown SoC. It has a lot of stuff and processing power in it. More importantly though, the datasheet says it will read out temperatures with an accuracy of 0.1 degrees Celsius, which is actually much lower than a lot of the combination temperature, pressure, humidity, and etc. sensors that I've seen out there. Connecting this thing up is super easy as well. It basically comes with these cables, and you just snap them in and plug it into your microcontroller. And you know, speaking of the microcontroller, I wasn't too thrilled with how messy this was getting with the wires hanging around and everything, so I decided to clean things up a little bit. Alright, so here is a project box that I've held on for a couple years that I was given to by Aaron over at the YouTube channel Hacker Shack like 2 years ago. Anyways, this turns out to be pretty spacious and kind of perfect for what I needed. So you can see that I've made some adjustments and I'll just walk through them real quick. Alright, so the first thing you might notice is that I've replaced the Photon with an Argon here. And the Argon comes with this external Wi-Fi antenna over here, which I'm still using, but I've actually since switched back to the Photon. The reason is that my Argon was having difficulty connecting to my Wi-Fi that the Photon didn't, and that's a shame because I really wanted to use the Bluetooth capabilities of the Argon. But they're both powered the same, so I cut a hole in the box and that's where I put the USB cable. Alright, as for the Viper remote, I wanted to get it a little bit more out of the way, so I ended up putting it at the bottom over here. And then I just have this extension cable that runs all the way to the digital out pins, same as the last video that I explained. Now the temperature sensors connect over I2C, so the yellow and blue wires go to SDA and SCL on the Argon, and there's also power and ground hookups. And these four wires I'm going to connect to this connector on the outside. So the outside, I've chosen a JST connector just because it's polarized, so there's no way that I'll stick this in the wrong way. And over here, I have the SparkFun quick cable, which I've modified to have the male end of the JST connector. And that lets me keep the temperature sensor outside of this box and closer to the main cabin, which is where I want to be measuring temperature. Now there's one more feature I added, kind of last minute, but I thought it'd be really cool to be able to measure the voltage of my house battery. So I have this DuPont pin out here, and once I connect the house battery of my van to it, I'll be able to measure the voltage with the Argon. Now there is a trick to doing this safely, because the house battery can be, you know, 12 to 16 volts, while the Argon is only able to measure voltages up to 3.3 volts. So what we can do is we can build a voltage divider circuit, and this basically divides the input voltage by about a factor of 10, so we can safely measure voltages up to around 30 volts. You can see that while I vary the house battery input voltage,
the output voltage right between the two resistors never goes above 3.3 volts. In addition, the current draw is pretty low as well, which means less power used. Alright, that's it for the hardware. Let's box this up and I'll show you where I put this in my van. Alright, so I found the perfect place for this project box, which is on the side of my van, right between the Cascade furniture and the insulation. I can just shove it in here and it fits super well. Once I connect all the wires up, I can just plug in the USB cable and the Argon should connect to the car's Wi-Fi. And for the most accurate temperature measurements, I put my temperature sensor right over here, right near where I'm living. Alright, let's move on to software. So I realize that looking at code is pretty boring, and I don't really want to do that when I'm not working, so instead, I thought I would just explain my general approach. If we were to plot the temperature of my van over the course of a day, it might look something like this, where it's the hottest around the afternoon, and then it slowly gets colder after the sun sets, it's coldest sometime in the early morning, and it gets warmer again the next day. Alright, and this basic pattern would just repeat pretty much every day, and it would look like this as long as we don't intervene in any way. But if I wanted my van to stay warmer than, say, 65 degrees at all times, then what I could do is I could define a threshold somewhere in the code. And this threshold would be set to the temperature that I want to maintain. And what would happen is, whenever the temperature sensor reads that the temperature has dropped, we could trigger an engine start event here. Now the default engine start time on the Viper unit that I have is 12 minutes long. And it is possible to end it early or extend it, but let's say I'm not going to mess with that right now. Let's just try the very easiest thing that works, and we'll just make it run for 12 minutes. Alright, now let's consider what's going to happen to the temperature with the engine start in play. So with this green line, you can see the temperature dropping as before, but once the engine turns on, the temperature is going to rise. And once the engine turns off, the temperature will continue to fall, just like before. But once it drops enough, it's going to run into our threshold again, and we're just going to turn the engine right back on. Alright, so I think you guys see the pattern. This is basically just going to keep repeating. It's going to keep turning the engine on, heat up, get cold, etc., up until we no longer run into the threshold and we're back to the normal daytime behavior. Now this is kind of the first thing that I tried that worked, and it's really simple, but it turns out that this approximates the behavior of a hysteresis thermostat. Basically, just an energy-efficient thermostat that tries to save power and reduce the number of engine restarts I have to do every night. Alright, now it's time to look at some real data. So this here is a dashboard that I use to visualize all of the sensor data that I collected from my van. I'll explain how to build one of these for yourself in another video. But for now, know that I'm collecting the metrics for temperature in Fahrenheit, the engine state, which is in yellow, and the house battery voltage down there in purple. First thing you'll notice is that the temperature, up in blue, is pretty similar to what we drew earlier, where it gets coldest around the morning at like 6 a.m. and then it's warmest in the evening. In this case, it looks like around 5 p.m. You can also see the point at which I activate the thermostat program, and then it tries to maintain that constant temperature threshold. Let's use the date selector to zoom in into more detail, just into this section. So you'll see that whenever the temperature, which is the blue line, goes below 65, the engine kicks on, and that's represented by the yellow line. And once the engine's on, then the temperature of the cabin rapidly increases up to around 72, and then once the engine turns off, the temperature starts falling back down. Also, to explain the spike in the house battery voltage, that's because the engine actually charges the house battery whenever it's on, and so when the engine's on, the house battery voltage suddenly appears higher because the alternator is actually charging the house battery. Now, there were 13 remote starts this night, and each one is for 12 minutes, so in total, we ran the engine something like 2.5 hours. It's difficult for me to tell just by looking at the gas gauge if I actually went through the expected 1.25 gallons. To find out, we'll have to take a look at usage over multiple days. I have some historical data over here, back when I was still kind of working out bugs in the system. So you can see, for instance, on January 29th, the program crashed in the middle of the night, and then it got quite cold in the van, and I had to fix that bug. But it was pretty good motivation to get that fixed. Anyways, I think in these 5 days, I went through something like a quarter or a third of my tank, which is basically as expected, or just a little bit worse. But either way, if I can get through 2 weeks on a single gallon of gas, that's great. Alright, one last thing to note is that when I want to turn on or off the thermostat, I use a Siri shortcut, which lets me input the target temperature and whether I'm heating or cooling. And so I will post this shortcut in the video description so that you can check it out yourself. So did very well for what I wanted from it, and I'm very happy with the results that I got. There are a few things I want to investigate in the future. First of all, it would be very good to increase the heat capacity of the van. This would mean that I would have to do fewer starts per night, be more energy efficient, be less noisy. A lot of good things come out of this. Adding insulation is one thing, I can definitely do that. It would be very interesting to do something like add tanks of water and then heat the water, and then that way the water can retain the heat and release it over longer periods of time. I'm not quite sure what a system that does that would look like, but it is an interesting possibility. The second thing to look at when the weather turns is cooling. So, you know, we talked about heating today, but the same technique can be used with the van's AC to cool the van down in the summertime when it's too hot outside. The final thing I would like to try one day is taking a spin in extreme cold and seeing how the van performs when it's like freezing or even colder outside. I think that would be very interesting. I think it would still be able to keep up, but we would probably be starting the engine a lot more at night. All right, that's it for the video. Thanks so much for watching, and if you have any questions, leave them in the comments below and I'll get back to you. See ya!